Thank you very much. Hi, guys. Good to see you here this afternoon. Thank you very much for coming. Our subject is eco-homes, reducing waste, saving water, energy, money, and the earth. Will you please welcome our expert speakers, Dr. Robert Crocker from the University of South Australia, who is the head of Zero Waste SA Research Centre for Sustainable Design and Behaviour. And also from UniSA, Dr. Martin Freney, an industrial design lecturer who, among other things, has an owner-built eco-house, straw-bale walls, passive solar design, reed bed for recycling grey water, composting toilet, the works. In fact, the house has everything that you need for a sustainable lifestyle. Martin will give us, as you can see here, a practical hands-on demonstration to show us how to use alternative building materials. Gentlemen, we have so much to talk about, so little time to do it in, so we'll start right away. And let's go to the problem first. And Rob, Zero Waste, head of Zero Waste South Australia Research Centre, it seems to me that we have so much more waste now than when I was a young boy growing up. In those days, Monday's collection day, bang go the bins, it was that big. And now you have a look down the street and you see how much waste is being taken away. And that's from a personal point of view, nothing to do with industry. Is that true?
Hello? Yeah. I think, we tend to treat waste, at least I do, in terms of a consumption problem. It's really a consumption problem. And that means that it's not only an individual issue, it's a systems issue. The way we make things not to last. We have markets full of very cheap items that are very accessible. There's maybe some positive things in this, but there's also a lot of negative things. And we have, too many things that are made to break. They end up in the water. There's 8 million... I mean, the latest figures, I think I've read 8 million tonnes a year
of plastics
in the sea, and that's probably a very small percentage of what we throw out and what ends up on the land and in other places it shouldn't be. And this becomes somebody else's problem, you know. So.
You actually have a book on the way called Somebody Else's Problem, in which I've had a look at a few of the notes. You mentioned the word overconsumption a lot.
Yes.
What do you mean by overconsumption?
Well, I mean that if, take mobile phones, my daughter has my first iPhone and it works fine. Last year I've got a Samsung. I had to change it 3 times because there was something wrong with the charger. Whenever you take it in, a technician assesses it for 2 minutes, then decides that it can't be fixed, and out it goes. You know, these objects are made really to be disposable. They're glued together. They're almost impossible to recycle. So what it means is they're really mined for their metals. They're not recyclable. And really, it's the tail wagging the dog. The marketing of systems of, if you like, provisioning systems for mobile phones, you know, Vodafone, etc. Mm-hmm. They need you to go in their store, all of you, at around year round. So what it means is that they want the producers like Apple to produce 2 or 3 a year. They want each producer to produce a new one in maybe 3 varieties, so that there's plenty of eye candy, plenty of gifts. And as you know, when you give somebody a gift, you feel obligated to them. So it's a way of sort of keeping customers they've already got in the tent and attracting new ones. So this whole system is really based upon their profitability.
But at the same time, they're producing products that cannot be fixed?
Yeah, yeah. So there's this sort of growing mountain of mobile phones, of e-waste,
and
it's
and
a very serious
problem.
When,
say you had three in a year, what happened to the other two that you took back and swapped?
Exactly. I have no idea, you know. This is a problem. When you, the time you were talking about, most people had some idea where their products came from. Not necessarily perfectly, but, you know, say 80 years ago, most of what you bought, you would have had a pretty good idea where they came from, either from England, usually, if they're imported, or locally made, and you could more or less tell what went into them. Now, most products are completely alien. You have no idea, you know. It's.
You also write about the democratization of luxury.
Ah, very important.
Can you define that?
Well, luxury is very mysterious. It's like an adjective, not a noun. It's like the.
It's a luxury car.
It's the rainbow. It's like the end of the rainbow, the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, because luxury tends to be applied as an adjective, if you like, to things that we need, like real things. You know, like you might need water to drink, but, you know, there's a kind of a beautiful, exquisite rosé or something you've discovered, you know, which is very expensive, say. I'm making it up. But, you know, so you don't just have water, you have, you know, special water. You might have clothes, you have branded luxury clothes that are perhaps $300
designer
a shirt.
Or yeah, fashionable.
Yeah. I was on a plane once from Japan, going to Europe, and just about everyone on the plane had gone to Italy to buy branded luxury shirts and things. And, you know, these are like $500 shirts. And I was talking to the people in the plane with me, and they said, yes, but in Japan, they're $1,500. And I was thinking, so luxury, you know, is very much in the eye of the beholder, you know. It's very much a, and it draws people in because they, it's almost like a guarantee that you're getting the best.
Rob, define democratization. What do you mean by that? Is it that more of us can enjoy luxury items
exactly,
now?
Exactly. So what it means is that what you do is, the typical way now is, say, I used to have a Golf. I've traded in for a Skoda. I'm going downhill, as it were, as people are going up. But you look at the way large companies like Volkswagen work. You have the Skoda, then you have the Volkswagen, then you have the Audi, and then you have the, I think, Bugatti or some really exotic, expensive cars. And what they'll do is they'll move the technology down the. So my Skoda has Volkswagen technology even 2 years ago, but I'm quite happy with that. But it's like the idea is that you can entice people with the dream of having something very special, you know, having a very usually it's a sensual thing, luxury, and that's why it tends to apply to things you wear, things you eat, things you drink, you know. But the democratization of luxury is something that really starts in the 18th century with, you know, tea, coffee, you know, all these exotic things which we then turned the world upside down to get hold of. So I guess one of the main arguments in my book is that, you know, the problem is very much a systems problem. We've inherited 100 years, 200 years of these systems, and these are what needs to be changed. You know? And that's why it's a very revolutionary moment that we're living in at the moment.
Are you talking about keeping up with the Jetsons?
Yeah, that's right. yeah, keeping up with the Joneses. I mean, that's again a very, very interesting issue. We're always looking over our shoulder. We're always looking at our peers. We're always looking at celebrities, seeing what they have. And, you know, and I think one of the problems with the media is that it's like a magnifying glass or an amplifier. It amplifies that tendency for us, because we're social beings, to always look at each other.
You're not going to blame the media.
No. Not this media.
But yes, no, I take the point. Everybody can see that the superstar is, whatever the superstar is doing, that's what we should also be looking for. Let's touch for a little bit just on food. And if I can bring you into this too, please, Martin. Let's talk about packaging in food and economies of scale by having large supermarkets, only a few of them, but Australia-wide, worldwide, and is there an alternative to that? Can you get as good a product f- for an affordable price another way?
Yeah, I think you can probably get a better product, say organic food, from a farmer's market. So there's, you know, a bit of a new trend in Australia where people are going to farmer's markets and places like the Central Market to sort of cut out the middleman, if you like, the Coles and the Woolies, and just go straight to the source and get something that they know has been grown in a, you know, much more sustainable way.
And I guess also cut out a bit of packaging too.
Exactly,
and less waste.
Yeah, yeah. Also, the other big issue with food is food miles, how far the food comes from. So again, if you're going to a farmer's market, you know it's come from, you know, a local supplier, hasn't had to travel halfway across the world, and it's probably in season, you know, it hasn't had to be refrigerated for a long time, so you've avoided a whole lot of environmental impacts.
As far as food's concerned, you have the perfect situation. When we talk about your home later, you've got your own chooks.
Right.
I guess veggie garden. Mm-hmm. Satisfaction in that?
Yeah, the veggie garden's not looking so great at the moment, I've got to confess, Rob, but we're thrilled with our chooks, which are a new addition. The chooks are little, you know, egg factory that turn our kitchen food scraps into eggs. So I can't think of a better system, really.
And it's a family thing too, because the kids can be part of it.
The kids love going to fetch the eggs and, you know, feeding the chooks. They take the kitchen scraps down and bring back an egg. So, it's fantastic.
It's not so much an alternative lifestyle as looking at the way things used to be. It's the sort of house we had back in the 50s.
Correct.
I wonder if this is one of the answers, whether we can see what was so good in the 50s and whether we can incorporate that into our modern, technologically revved up.
I think with food waste, the problem is very similar to the, you know, what I was talking about with mobile phones, etc. You're looking at a system where there's waste, where the farmers are forced to throw out fresh food that doesn't look perfect. There's waste, you know, in the shipping of potatoes. I just heard that walnuts we buy here that we think are from Tasmania, they're opened in China. So they're shipped to China and then back. So, you know, this kind of extraordinary waste of energy, of time, to chase that extra dollar is extraordinary.
But the reason for that, is the labour cost in China?
Exactly. So the difficulty really, in my view, is that we are wedded to this juggernaut, which, you know, we have in place. But I really feel that it will change because we can't really afford to go on like this. You know, for example, I know somebody who's setting up a food co-op. He's using software that will connect growers directly to his shop. So it means that he can sell really small packages of things. You know, you might have some lemons, box of lemons. He can say, okay, send him on email or something, I've got a box of lemons. He'll say, okay, $10, will you deliver? Yes. You know, and it all happens. And I think you'll find more and more of this will occur and start to cut out the, Chinese garlic and all the other weird things we get, you know, which have been...
The blueberries.
Yeah, the blueberries, not to mention the blueberries. Because there are costs involved, which, you know, we will end up paying for as a community. So.
And if something like this was to be successful, people would go there and they would get their fruit and their vegetables in a paper bag.
Exactly.
Or take your green bag. Take your green bag and just fill it up.
In paper
he
bags.
Sells paper bags.
He sells paper bags.
Sells paper bags. I'd like you to tell us, if you will, with some detail, about the Living Lab at Tonsley. I've heard it said it is the seventh wonder of Adelaide.
Yeah, please go out and have a look.
I hadn't,
the roof
I hadn't
is
heard
extraordinary.
Of it.
Yeah, it's got probably the biggest roof, I think, in Australia. I don't know. Must be close. 8 hectares of roof.
And this is the old Mitsubishi plant.
Okay. Of course.
Okay, we'll say one of.
Well, it certainly must be one of the biggest reuse projects. It's huge because they've kept the roof. They worked out it was cheaper to keep it than take it all down and build another one. It's my involvement is in this research project called Adelaide Living Labs. And some of you might have come across Joss's Josh's house on TV, which is in Perth, which is another living lab. A living lab really is a place where you wire things up and you try and aim to create an environment which is zero carbon, if you like. You know, and you do this iteratively over a period of time. So you'll start with one system and you'll try and make it better, and you'll study it as you do it. So my role in it is highly untechnical. I'm the talker, because we are involved in our little unit in co-creation, which is a very important part of this. Co-design or co-creation is where you talk to everyone, including builders and developers, so that they understand what they're doing. Because if you're trying to develop green technologies in building systems, it's no good if you've got a plumber who's a two-star plumber in an eight-star building. You know, the plumber has to know what they're doing. So, you know, we've got projects there involving electricity, water, waste. You know, it's very much a growing thing. But the aim is to create an environment which is zero carbon, which is very much part of green industries. Green industries is supposed to be the successor of Zero Waste SA, which is happening later in the year, but their aim is very much to create, to make Adelaide a totally green city. And I'm sort of find myself part of this. So.
That's why you can use the title Zero Waste SA, yeah, because that is close to an aim?
That's it. I mean, zero waste is a terrible thing in a way, because it assumes you're sort of in dreamland, you know, but really it's very important because it's a goal which is, I think, achievable if we change these systems. But we have to identify the problems and then start
to change
the
systems. Does it involve design or behaviour?
Both. Very much both. That's why I'm kind of involved. The centre's called the Centre of Sustainable Design and Behaviour. Because without behaviour change, it's very, very, very difficult. And that's why, you know, I've been talking about things like democratisation of luxury and the role of luxury, imitation, you know, that sort of thing. Because really, to change behaviour, you have to get people to understand why they're doing what they're doing.
You've got to know what the problem is.
That's right. And also, I think, you know, you have to, in a way, bring, you have to bring the rich along with you, because they are the sort of the head of the snake. You know, they're the ones whose desires influence everybody else down the later on. They're the ones who will go to Bali and build a green villa, and then suddenly Bali's full of green villas and plastic rubbish, you know. Do you know what I mean? So,
is the living lab open to the public yet?
Well, the living lab is really a research project, so you can certainly tour Tonsley. You can take a tour. They love to see people. Bowden Brompton is the Bowden project is also part of the Living Lab, as is Lockheel Park. Lockheel Park's already been built, and we've learnt a lot from Lockheel Park, because we had a lot of buildings there we were wiring up and actually working out what people do in their homes, you know, with their power. Because one of the problems you face is that if you, say, introduce, say you give everyone free sustainable light bulbs, this is what happened in Holland, they suddenly put them up in their sheds. You know what I mean? They will put them everywhere. And in Holland, they predicted that by doing this, they'd cut power by 50%. And when they actually looked at it, they found it was only about 20%. Because suddenly people were lighting their sheds, and you know, suddenly there was cheap electricity, you see. So cost comes into this a lot.
as we inch our way to talking about Martin's eco home and to actually see what has been done with Bowden, for instance. And there is another low-energy development that you've also been involved in. What are some of the practical things that have gone into that? Passive solar, for instance?
Yeah, it's a siting of buildings. Sorry, yeah. Things like the siting of the buildings, most obviously. Materials, the insulation, critical. Power, the way power is used. We're very interested in decentralising power, And in Tom's...
By decentralising power, do you mean getting off the grid?
Yeah.
Almost off the grid.
Almost off the grid. I think Tonsley will be... will probably get to the point where it is, to or large parts of it will be, because we're going to cover most of that roof, I believe. In you're talking to the wrong person. I'm just sort of one of a team, you know, but I know...
We find it very interesting.
Modelling plays a very important role in this. You know, the sort of mathematical modelling of demand, you know, to work out how to reduce power and the technologies and the systems and the materials that are most effective. So, you know, but my interest is more in the behavioural side. You know, as you probably guessed, don't give me any numbers.
Yeah. Overconsumption.
That's it.
Now, Martin, you've got practical experience. Can you tell us what is your house? What have you done? Martin's an industrial design lecturer, and I don't know about you, but when I think of industrial design, I think of Alessi, Philippe Starck, I think of chrome, of plastics, of cutting edge cutting edge designs and things that are really out there. And yet, when I hear you talk about your house, it is much more basic than that.
Yeah, well, that's right, Rob. I mean, I think there's beauty and simplicity. There's sort of fewer things to go wrong. If you can kind of keep it simple, that's sort of a bit of a design axiom. So, yeah, you can see the straw bale out the front. We built our home out of straw bales to build the walls. And the wonderful thing about straw bales is that they are essentially a waste material from agriculture. Often straw gets burnt, you know, causing pollution. Whereas if you bale it up, it makes a fantastic building material because it provides such wonderful insulation. It's probably about at least three times better than your average house wall with fiberglass insulation in it. So it means that you don't need to do a lot of heating and cooling. In our home, we don't have an air conditioner. And we only really suffer a little bit, you know, in a real heat wave. So it deals with, you know, anything up to about 40 degrees quite well without the air conditioner. The other great thing about straw bales is they're really kind of user friendly. They're like these big Lego blocks that you, your friends and family can just kind of put together. We got our walls up in a weekend. And then we spent a couple of years actually rendering with mud. And I'm going to do a little demonstration of the mud rendering in due course. But aside from sort of the walls, as Rob was saying, you know, things like insulation in the roof is really important, of course, because hot air rises and you want to have a really well insulated roof. Things like double glazed windows, which is becoming more common now, but... you know, here in Australia, we have a tricky climate to deal with because we do get quite cold in the winter. We do need to heat our homes. And yet in the summer, we have these heat waves now to deal with. And double glazing helps in both those areas because...
And we can all do that retrospectively. We can all do it.
We can, yeah. It can cost a lot of money to double glaze, but there are cheaper solutions. For example, if you want a really cheap solution, you just spray your window with some water and you put a piece of bubble wrap over your window. So, of course, you can't see out quite as well, but this is something you would probably just do in the winter. But people actually do this to save energy and actually make a difference to their, you know, energy bill and to, you know, their sort of eco footprint, if you like. So there are other products where you can just sort of magnetically attach a plastic, sort of plastic double glazing. So there are various solutions for different budgets. So, you really have to think about the what we call the thermal envelope of the home, how you're sort of dealing with the energy that's moving in and out of it, you know, as the weather is changing. So that's where straw bales and insulation comes in, double glazing. But also you need to think about, and of course that's directly related to your energy use for how much you use your air conditioner or your heater. But also thinking about water is really important because water is actually sort of embodied energy. It takes a lot of electricity to pump water from point A to point B. There's also a hell of a lot of, you know, infrastructure with, you know, pipes and, you know, reservoirs and dams. And of course, we all know about the, you know, the problems with the River Murray. you know, when we don't get adequate flows and, you know, we might be on water restrictions and this kind of thing. So thinking about your water use, and this was part of our reason for wanting a composting toilet, is that we use dramatically less water. And any water we do use in the home gets recycled outdoors for irrigation via a reed bed system.
And do you have tanks to get your own water?
Yes, we do. We have mains water, but we try to just live off the rainwater. And that also sort of drives our behaviour. You know, Rob's been talking about behaviour change. And I think, it's been shown that people who install photovoltaic solar panels on their roof to produce electricity, and people who install rainwater tanks, all of a sudden, once they're producing their own water and electricity, they become a lot more aware of their use of water and electricity, and they change their behaviour to, you know, conserve those valuable resources. Sort of the light bulb goes on for them once they're thinking, wow, I can make this stuff myself, now I want to save it for some reason.
Now, that's been talking about the things that are coming into your house. Now let's talk about the things going out of your house.
Okay. Waste.
Yes.
We're talking waste again. All right, waste. I talked already about the food scraps. We've also got human waste is a big one. And if you think about your home and how functional your home would be without your toilet, that's a really important waste that you need to be able to deal with. And of course, the composting toilet is great because you're turning waste into a valuable resource, which is once it's been properly composted, you know, with worms and thyme, you know, 6 months or so to compost perhaps, then it's something that you can put on your fruit trees. Maybe not your veggies. I mean, people do that, but the advice is not to put it on your veggies. But it's a great fertilizer for fruit trees. It doesn't smell after it's been through the composting process. It just looks like soil. So that's a fundamental problem that, you know, all over the planet there are just billions of people literally who don't have access to a decent toilet.
Yes.
And I think it's really foolish actually to mix, you know, essentially fresh drinking water with poo. It's a bad idea.
I've got to ask, it's hygienic?
It's hygienic, yeah. We're not sort of suffering constantly from, you know, any diseases or...
And the effects of your reed bed. When it gets down to the bottom of your reed bed, what's the quality of the water like there?
Well, the way it works is, obviously all the poo is collected in a big plastic barrel, and I've seen fantastic wheelie bin designs where the poo goes into a wheelie bin, and once it's full, you put in a fresh one, and that one just, you know, throw some worms in and a bit of soil on top. You could even plant a little garden in the top of your wheelie bin. It's a brilliant system, Rob, that really... I think we could do a lot more of, even in suburbia. I mean, I'm lucky I live on 4 acres where there's room to do some composting and this kind of thing, but I'm sure we can evolve these systems to, be more amenable to the suburbs and really provide... We really need to work out how we can provide a toilet to everyone on the planet, and I don't think it's going to involve flushing, you know, poos out to the sewage treatment plant. Yeah.
We will have questions. We hope that we've got about 10 minutes for questions later on. So if you're thinking of anything that we've missed out on, keep it in the back of your mind, and we'll have a questions from the floor later. Rob, anything before Martin goes down and shows us how to do the straw bales? Anything?
I just want to sort of say that what you were saying earlier about the 1950s and this idea that we could go back to the situation where we had very little rubbish. And I remember my old dad, who grew up in that period, waste not, want not. And I think most people have grandparents in this situation, or great-grandparents. I used to notice that his neighbours all had bins overflowing with food waste and packaging. And he'd have this tiny little plastic bag down the bottom of his bin, and that was his whole week's supply of rubbish. And there'd be maybe a couple of bottles. And I think it's really that he grew up at a time when you had to dispose of your own rubbish. So, you know, getting back to what Marty was saying, it's you take an interest when you have to do it yourself. When you don't, it's somebody else's problem. It goes down to the sea or somewhere else, you know. And this is a real issue today, because we're all locked into these systems that are incredibly wasteful.
Now, we have some tips here too. We have tips for reducing waste, saving water, energy, the earth, etc. These are available here. Can people in the audience pick up these forms? Okay, you've already done it. Sorry, I'm telling you nothing. It's a good read, though. If you get a chance, sit down between acts sometime today, have a look at that, and that's something that we can all do. You know, we can always say, well, the multinationals are this and the multinationals are that, but we can all reduce our use of energy, save our water. We can all do it step by step, and who knows? You know, we might be able to help the planet out. Martin, it's all yours.
Okay. Thanks, Rob. So what I've got in this bucket here is mud. And this is the way people have built their homes for a very long time. You will have heard of rammed earth and mud brick homes. And all throughout Africa and many other developing countries, mud is, you know, the material of choice because it's so freely available. There's probably, you know, about 1 cent worth of sand, which I've had to buy in here, but mainly it's just the earth off my piece of land. And ideally, you have a bit of clay, which is, I mean, generally there is clay in your soil in different amounts, and it's the clay that kind of makes it all stick and bind together. And so the beauty of this material is it's super versatile. You can build, as I said, rammed earth walls where it gets compacted with mechanical devices or just hand tampers. Or you can build mud bricks. What I'm going to use it for today is to actually just put it on this straw bale. And you can see it sticks beautifully, sort of bites into all the sort of the ends of the straw. And I am going to spill a bit. That's why they asked me to bring a tarp. But another fantastic thing about it is that I don't really need to wear any special safety gear for doing this. Like if this was a cement render or a lime render, I would need to have rubber gloves on. But this is actually good for your skin. What would my mother say? She loves all this stuff. So I think you're getting the idea. I probably won't go too much further with this, but then what you do is with a wooden float, you can smooth that off. And you can sort of spend as much time as you like. You can use a metal float, and that will get a much smoother finish. And as I said, it is quite a laborious process. It took us a really long time to do our home. There's about... Oh, really? Can't see me?
What we're doing here is people at the back are having trouble seeing. So we've got a little drop sheet, and up goes the straw bale.
Okay.
And can you see from the back now? Can you see a little better? As you can see, Martin's got the mud, enjoying it, putting it on wood float first, and then finishing it off with a metal float.
Yeah, you stack these like bricks so that they overlap, and some people kind of pin them together with bamboo stakes, or another method is to sort of throw a wire right over the top, and that gets tensioned down to the footing that the bales sit on. So that gives it a lot of stability. Usually you'll just have some timber framing wherever there are doors and windows and that kind of thing. So these things, you can cut the strings and change the size of the bales. You can even go at them with a chainsaw and sort of carve into them and make little niches where you can have a candle or, you know, a little sort of shelf or something like that. So, I think, you know, probably to kind of conclude this little demo, the mud is a really ecological material. There's very little what we call embodied energy, which is, you know, the energy that goes into producing a material. So all we've had to do really is have some sand delivered. Of course, there's mining involved with sand. So, you know, it's not like sand is some magical ingredient with no environmental impact, but it's far less than something like cement. which is a sort of more typical rendering material. And also, I think the interesting thing about this is that it's something that you can do yourself, so it really gets you involved in thinking about your home. You sort of fall in love with your home a little bit more, you understand how it works, you're more likely to look after it and maintain it and that kind of thing. So so that's that for the straw bale demo. Now, I'd like to...
Martin, you've had yours for the best part of 20 years.
More like 12.
Okay.
12, yeah.
Does it wear? Does it crack? Does it get wet?
I'm only just now having to start doing a little bit of maintenance on it. Yeah, I've got a bit of a patch just near where the wood heater is. And I've noticed that the render's not standing up so wonderfully there, but it's all easy to fix. So.
And it is used around the world too, isn't it?
Yeah, this is ancient technology which is provided for us for millennia. And I we've got all these amazing new building products these days, and you know they can be good, but you know I think you have trouble beating this really. As I was saying before, this wall is so energy efficient just because, partly because it's so thick, you know, it's just so much insulation there that it takes a long time for heat to move through that super thick structure.
It's not load bearing.
It's not load bearing. They can be load bearing, but engineers don't like it. They get nervous, but they have been done. Also, what I've got here is a little sample of hempcrete. You may have heard of hemp, hempcrete. I'm sure you've all heard of hemp. Hemp is a wonderful plant that is easy to grow, requires, you know, very little or zero pesticide, very little in the way of fertilizer. We're not allowed to grow it in South Australia because of our drug laws. They don't distinguish between cannabis or marijuana and hemp. But in the eastern states, you can grow hemp. And when it sort of gets pulverized, it makes a light, fluffy material. And that light, fluffy material, you bind it together, you glue it together with a lime mixture. And I can pass that around if you'd like to have a look at the hempcrete. Again, that's also not structural. So you do still need to have a frame, but that is fantastic insulation as well. And also thermal mass. Thermal mass is sort of the opposite to insulation. Thermal mass helps regulate temperatures, sort of even them out and stabilize them and even store temperature or store energy. So thermal mass is things like mud bricks and concrete, whereas insulation is preventing heat flow through a building. So that is an interesting combination of thermal mass and insulation. The straw bale is just insulation. Now I'd like to show you something I'm sort of super interested in at the moment. I'm building a little bed and breakfast called Earthship Iron Bank. I've used about 1,000 car tires to build the walls of the bed and breakfast. So I think I'm going to do this up here. Is that right? And it uses these waste materials. Australians make about 48 million waste car tyres every year, and you'll be horrified to know that most of those tyres go back to Asia because we've got all these empty shipping containers, and we figure, well, what can we send back to Asia? We're going to send back some car tyres where they get burnt. They get burnt for energy, which is not such a terrible idea, but I think because there is a lot of energy in these things. They burn for ages. It's a great fuel. But the particulate emissions, the pollution into the atmosphere is not a good thing. So by using another waste material, cardboard, and again, this is cardboard is highly recyclable. So, you know, I do have some just little problems about doing this, but I think it's a reasonably good thing to do with cardboard. We're making a new sort of building material here. What you do is you put a little bit of cardboard in the bottom of the tire. That's probably just a bit big. You can see it's very easy to work with. That sort of goes in the inside the tire so that dirt can't fall out the bottom, because you need to sort of imagine that you've already done these two tires here. And this one goes on top, and of course there's this little gap in the middle where the dirt would fall through. So that's what the cardboard is for, and that's non-structural. That can sort of rot away eventually, because by that time the dirt that I'm about to put in there is all compacted. So next step. Is you put in some more of this dirt stuff that we've got everywhere. It's free, cheap, readily available, user-friendly, a little bit dusty. And then, should have my gloves on now. One of the downsides to tyres is they sometimes have redbacks in them, but I checked these tyres before. Now, what I'm about to do is to compact the dirt into here. And everyone who comes along to my Earthship workshops, Earthship is the name of sort of the housing concept that has popularized this technique here. They say, Marty, isn't there a machine that could do that? And I'm like, yeah, there is. But that wouldn't be as much fun, would it? Because what you find is when you've got 10 or so people come over and, you know, just tell a few jokes and pound a few tyres, the next thing you know, and I was thinking about it, if everyone who came to WOMAD just did half a tyre, we would have the most amazing community structure here, just sort of, you know, made out of waste materials. Think about it. What are you going to do with a car tyre when it reaches the end of its life? I figure this is a pretty good idea. You can still recycle this when the house gets knocked over. You can still get all these tyres and burn them or shred them or do whatever you want to do with the tyres. So I sort of see it as it's really reuse, and it's just prolonging the lifespan of this product, which, let's face it, you know, a lot of materials went into producing it, and I'm making a mess now. I'll be in trouble. But yeah, I think you get the idea. I probably won't keep going, but these are actually a great material. You can actually pump more dirt under there to get it all nice and level. So, you know, the final step is to get out the level, and you sort of look at the tire next to it. So usually I try to select the same size tyres, and the size is kind of conveniently written on the rim, so you can get the same, you know, roughly the same height. You look for that tread width, roughly the same for your whole course. You can start with the larger tyres on the bottom of your wall with smaller ones on the top, and it's very, you know, after half an hour of being shown how to do this, you're an expert. So it's easy to learn. It's a bit like the straw bales. It is hard work, but you know, it's doable, and there are ways you can mechanize it if you don't feel like doing it by hand, just with machinery. Same with the rendering, you can spray the render on with a concrete pool pump. So, how do you finish that? We can put mud on that. Let's do that. That's a good idea. Thank you for that question. So that. The guy who invented this, Michael Reynolds, an American architect, he says if you gave him $1 million to design the ideal building material, he would design a tire. And part of the problem, is that, so I was going to say, because there's this tread on here, you know, it's got that texture like the straw bale that actually lets the mud stick to it. And, you know, you end up with this shape in here, that all just gets filled in with lots of mud. So you build up to a layer, maybe about an inch thick over the tire. And, you know, this then sort of deals with any concerns there may be with off-gassing from the tires. A lot of people think, oh, I wouldn't want them in my house. But once it's got a good cover of render over it, the tires are sort of protected from UV light or just air, water, all that kind of thing that might sort of tend to cause off-gassing. Really, the off-gassing occurs on the road. And you know, in the tire showroom. So these are basically free materials. Go to any tire retailer except Bob Jane; they won't give them to you.
From Bob Jane here?
Maybe they'll change their policies after my talk. That's how you fire. Yeah. I should point out that there's actually a company in New South Wales, a civil engineering company, who build retaining walls out of car tyres. They've done all the bushfire testing, structural engineering, water leachate. So they're looking at, you know, what happens when water comes into contact with them and sort of soaks out into the environment. Is that a problem? No, it's not. So they've done a lot of research on tyres in the environment. CSIRO tested, and it's good up to about not quite the top two bushfire hazard levels. So they can be built in bushfire zones, and we are in a bushfire zone. And you know, some of the things you can do is, instead of putting the mud render on it, you can put steel cladding, or there are other sort of engineering methods to enable you to still build with straw bale in a really high bushfire zone. Yeah. I was really worried about the how the council would respond to the tyres, and I didn't make a big song and dance about it. I actually said they were rendered, stabilised, rammed earth walls, and they liked the sound of that, because you see, the problem is it's all about people's perception, and it's like Rob was saying about luxury, and you know what people sort of perceive to be a luxurious item. You know, by calling it a rendered, stabilised, rammed earth wall, that sounded better than a wall made out of old tyres. Because these, to me, aren't really tyres. These are like that ultimate building material. They're steel coated in rubber, so strong, so durable. You think about all the things we do to tyres, you know, all sorts of weather and like chemicals and all sorts of things. Very durable, yes.
Steel coated in rubber. If you talk to Bridgestone, they'll tell you there's very, very little rubber in them now.
And well, it's a synthetic rubber.
Yeah, and that's why it breaks down, and your tyres aren't any good after about 7 years.
Yeah.
So how does that tyre compare to the real tyres with proper rubber in them?
Yeah, I don't think tyres have proper rubber in them anymore. You're quite right. And an interesting thing I read the other day in a New Scientist magazine was that they're now synthesising synthetic rubbers out of dandelions. So in the future, we will be driving our, you know, cars. And I think we're going to have cars into the future, right? Tyres aren't going away. We've got to find something to do with them. But yeah, there are nasty things in tyres, but it doesn't have to be that way. We could be making them out of dandelions. I think the long-term durability is really good if they are protected with things like render, waterproofing barriers, and this kind of thing. But, yeah, okay, yeah, a few more questions.
I was wondering about exterior renders, if it's not protected under a roof.
Then that's where you need to use something like cement or lime to waterproof the earthen render, because it will wash off, yeah. But the most important thing I want to say about the earthship is not really the tyres. It's really the idea that it's a self-sufficient building that's driving this sustainable behaviour change. Because as I said before, once you live in a home that is providing all its own energy, and this earthship idea is that the house is just totally self-sufficient. It's got batteries to store electricity, it's got rainwater tanks to store water, and it's got a wastewater system that you can actually grow food in. So here is a home that grows food, that keeps you warm or cool without energy. Really, it just does it because it's got all this thermal mass or all this insulation. And it's changing your behavior every day, because you've got to look outside and go, is it sunny today? Okay, it's sunny, so I know my batteries are going to be full. So I can do energy intensive stuff. You know, I can do some vacuuming or do a load of washing. But if it's not, if it's an overcast day, you have to go, oh, hold on, maybe I changed my behavior today and I'll wait for a sunny day tomorrow or something. Or you make that decision, if I do this, then I can't do this. You know, I can't watch movies tonight because I've flattened my batteries, you know, doing something else. So that's the kind of, that's what kind of happens when you're in this self-sufficient home. And I don't know how we actually do that on a larger scale. I've sort of been thinking, how would you simulate that, you know, for people who are on the grid? How would you say, you know, maybe it's just some little alarm that goes off and says you've actually used up your energy for today, and, you know, you should be more careful and, you know, that kind of thing. Because unless you've got the threat of your batteries going flat or your rainwater tanks being emptied, you're like, hey, I don't care. I've got power and water on tap, unlimited. It's just limited only by what I can pay for.
Cheers. You could turn what in some parts of the world is seen as a negative, in that they've got mains power but it doesn't work all the time. You could turn that into a positive. So, yes, you've got mains, but maybe it's only accessible between this hour and that hour.
Right, yeah. I mean, I think the problem is with our current lifestyle, it's going to be really inconvenient. You know, if we don't have power for that hour of the day, you know, that's the hour when, you know, you've got to send that critical email or something. You know, it's going to be really frustrating. Your business won't work, or, you know, you can't get the kids to school or something because you got an electric car. I think the idea with, the housing we're trying to provide to people is we don't want to make life too difficult for them. We want to have all the mod cons, but how do we do it sustainably? You know, and I think it's about, on our little flyer there, it says that, you know, how are you going to save water? Well, have showers instead of baths, or, you know, how do you do better than that? You know, just maybe have showers less often. Like, how many people have a shower every day? Like, why do you do that? You know, look at your kids. They hate having baths and showers. So just, you know, you can use less water in that way. Sometimes I just have a little bird bath where I fill up the hand basin, you know, with a little flannel towel. You just wash the dirty bits, you know? So...
Madam?
Any other questions? Battery recycling. Okay, just quickly, I've had a question about battery recycling. Batteries are highly recyclable. Lead acid batteries, you can recycle, you know, 98% of the lead. Battery technology is changing day by day. Elon Musk, the Tesla Motors CEO, he's building what's called the Gigafactory, which is making just stupendous amounts of batteries for electric vehicles. So the battery technology is changing, and because it is in a little battery, it's this bit that you can take somewhere where, fingers crossed, they're going to do something sensible with it. Take it apart and, you know, build a new battery, hopefully. Or, you know, at least deal with those materials in a sensible way. And someone asked about load-bearing. These are load-bearing. The straw bales can be load-bearing. That gets rid of a whole lot of materials that you'd otherwise need for the structure.
We only have about 5 minutes to go. Do you have any questions you'd like to ask Dr. Rob Crocker? Oh, madam?
Mine will probably go to both of them. I live in Christie Walk, which is an eco-housing unit here in Adelaide, in the city. My power bill is $30 a month. My waste to landfill is one small supermarket bag, and my water bill is $100 a quarter because it's split between 27. Our biggest problem, though, is at the moment is developers. We're about to have a development go through nearby, which will cut our solar power and our community garden. Do you think there should be some sort of protection for developments when they do go in, if they have an eco feature to them, or do you think we should just try and
good question. Just before you started to mention the developers, I was going to ask if you'd like to come up here and talk next year. Well done.
I'd love to. I'm going back to New Zealand because I can't get a job in sustainability here.
Rob?
Oh, yes, very good issue, very good point. Development brings out the worst in us, in the sense that there has to be rules and legislation to protect people against people who are perhaps doing things that inconvenience others or really damage their interests. And I don't think we've got it quite right. We've moved from one sort of extreme to another. And this is the kind of thing that I've heard many, many times. Solar panels are vulnerable to that, you know, people overshadowing them. I think this is the sort of thing that will become a hot topic, you know, in the future. And hopefully our politicians will listen, you know, to us, not just the people with deep pockets, which is a problem.
Great talk, thank you. One thing that I think should be considered is that we've got a lot of existing housing stock, and I think it would be a shame if people took away from this that they should wait until they've got their eco home and then they'll be sustainable. You can do it right now, and maybe you guys can talk a bit to that, please.
Yes, I totally agree. I was actually going to bring this up. I think there's very few homes that should be demolished straight away. Most of them have a life in them, and most of what we've been talking about can be done to existing homes using better insulation, double glazing. You know, often these are quite cheap solutions. They don't need to be massively expensive. And I, for example, had a neighbour who had a beautiful old villa, 1900, decided he was going to do it up and sell it, so he made it look like the inside of a magazine, sold it, went round the corner, demolished another one, and then built what he thought was a green home. And I kept saying to him, look, don't do it. So it's you're absolutely right. You know, we should work with the housing stock we have. And I think one of the beauties of what Marty's doing is he's working with waste materials. I'm very involved in this, and there's a big conference coming up in May, 21st to the 24th, and I'm hoping to have all the keynote speakers make public talk. It's called Unmaking Waste. So if you look up unmakingwaste2015.org on the net, you'll see some news about it. But some of those people are doing very interesting things. Speaking of tyres, there's a lady in New South Wales who's worked out how to take out the nasty things out of burning tyres, which is a fantastic gift to Asia, you know, because they've got these tyres, and she's worked out a technology that removes a lot of most of the toxins from the burning tyres. So there's no permanent solution. You have to see it as a moving platform, because we're shifting from a situation which is really unsustainable, which hopefully becomes more sustainable as we go.
Just really quickly, I think addressing that question, you've got to remember that it's not the homes that are creating the problems, it's the people in the homes. So you can sort of make any home into an eco home just by putting some eco people into it. People who aren't having a shower every day and, you know, that kind of thing.
Two more questions. There's one here.
Yeah, just a practical one. I was just wondering what the ratio of clay to sand is in the render.
It changes depending on the soil, but right here we've got three parts sand to one part clay.
And how do you feel it, Marty? It's not wet, you do it firm?
Yeah, it's quite tolerant. That's quite a sloppy mix there. That's just the way it came out, but yeah, you get the hang of it.
And I think final question here. Madam? Yeah, very good question.
Because I'm currently at the stage now where I'm just about to build a house, and we are discussing the solar panel issue, and some people were saying wait a few more years and it'll be massively cost effective in that the technology has improved so much. But are they super efficient now? Is it a good investment still?
Well, before the experts speak, I talked to David Suzuki probably 6-8 years ago when he was in Adelaide, and we were talking solar at that stage, and he said that in Tokyo, a good 6 years ago, they had a solar panel that looked like a roofing tile. So you could do your roof, and it would look like roofing tiles rather than the quite obvious solar panels that we have.
Can I have a plug for a local company, the last surviving company making panels here, Tindo? You should go and talk to them because they're doing some very interesting new developments in plug-in panels and, yeah, all right?
The efficiency is increasing all the time.
Yeah, well, the last presentation I heard, they have evolved a panel which won't need an inverter. The really expensive stuff is the other gear. And the idea is that these panels have their own, so you can just assemble them on a roof. So that's what I heard. But it may be another year or two before this is there. But as I was saying, you've got to stop thinking in terms of the solution, the final solution. There's no final solution. It's a progressive thing. Whatever you have, try and deal with as you go. You know, that's my advice. I inherited a house. I bought a house owned by somebody very wealthy before me, and they had 60 downlights. And I think, what do I do? So like, you know, I'm slowly kind of converting them all, you know. And I'm doing little things, and I have built a very eco shed, which I do my writing in, which is all secondhand materials. But it's a, you know, really it's your situation, where you are, and don't sort of feel you have to solve all the problems at once, because that's where people often go to extremes and find that they're out of pocket or, yeah? So that's my advice.
If you don't put your foot in the water, you won't get a wet toe.
Yeah. You've got to try. You've got to do your best, that's but right. don't sort of burn everything, you know, on the way.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid our time is up. I knew that we wouldn't have enough. Thank you very much for your attention. I'd like to thank our two speakers, Dr. Martin Freney, Dr. Rob Crocker. Will you please put your hands together for them? Thank you. Because the next act is about to begin somewhere. About now. So please enjoy. Enjoy your afternoon. Thank you for coming here today, and thank you for coming to WOMAD. Enjoy yourself. Thank you.